And that's important. The Great Depression was a serious crisis. There should have been a national response from the federal government. The Supreme Court was preventing that. But the Great Depression is not the only crisis that FDR gets. There's another one, a crisis that echoes down the years. It finds some parallels in our recent history, and it shapes our modern understanding of the Constitution and the role of judges. On December 7th, 1941, the Empire of Japan attacks the United States fleet at Pearl Harbor. The destruction is enormous. All 8 battleships are damaged, 2 totally lost. Over 300 aircraft are damaged or destroyed, and 2,400 service members are killed. More than the material devastation, though, the attack inflicts a psychological injury. Americans aren't used to being attacked at home. Wars are things that are fought across the sea, not on American soil. So the immediate reaction is panic. Are more attacks coming? Is this part of a coordinated series of strikes? In fact, it was, though only one took place in America. And people wonder what's next. In Washington, D.C., troops are called out to protect government buildings. People empty supermarkets and hoard food. And government lawyers write memos about what can be done to make the country safe. One idea that they come up with relatively quickly is removing the Japanese and Japanese Americans from the West Coast. And this is in large part the brainchild of one man, a lawyer named Carl Bendetson. At this point, there's a Japanese and Japanese American population of about 127,000 in the United States. They live mostly on the West Coast. The Issei, the first generation of immigrants, are not US citizens. They're not allowed to be. But their children and their grandchildren, the Nisei and the Sansei, are US citizens by virtue of the 14th Amendment's grant of birthright citizenship to anyone born in this country. This population has had some difficulty assimilating because of racism and suspicion. And in fact, before Pearl Harbor, US intelligence agencies investigated the Japanese American community because they were concerned about possible disloyalty. The conclusion by the Office of Naval Intelligence was that there was no general problem with disloyalty. There might be some disloyal individuals, but on the whole, the Japanese American community was actually hyper-patriotic and eager to assimilate. As far as suspicious individuals were concerned, the FBI had been keeping tabs on certain community leaders and figures of prominence. And immediately after the Pearl Harbor attack, they went in and they arrested over 5,000 Japanese and Japanese Americans. That is, most of the men who had any kind of leadership position in the community. And they sent those people to Justice Department camps. And then for some weeks afterward, there was really no talk of mass detention. But public opinion turned against the Japanese Americans. Outside the government, the push was coming from groups like the Salinas Fruit Growers Association, which wanted to eliminate the economic competition of the Japanese farms, and the Native Sons of the Golden West, which simply wanted to make California white. Inside the government, it was coming from the War Department. And the Justice Department resisted. This is one of the lesser known elements of this story. The War Department keeps coming to the Justice Department asking for the authority to do certain things. We want to do warrantless searches on Japanese American houses. We want to arrest all of the Bainbridge Island residents. And the Justice Department keeps saying no. Francis Biddle, FDR's Attorney General, keeps saying this is unconstitutional, we won't do it. But he isn't, in the end, willing to take a strong enough stand against these measures and ultimately against the detention program.